So again, good afternoon. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to present a recently published work that has to do with the vertical distribution of high mass X-ray binaries in NGC 55. Actually, this work describes the methodology used in order to complement observational data with statistical analysis for modeling and estimating the displacement of high mass X-ray binaries from star forming regions. And from that distribution, the next step is to estimate the respective center of mass transfer velocity distribution. This analysis is based on a few high mass X-ray binary characteristics. First of all, is that they are associated with star forming region. Although they are associated with star forming region, there is observational evidence that some X-ray binaries as offset are displaced from those star forming regions. And that displacement is attributed to natal kicks after an asymmetric supernova explosion during the formation of the compact object. Now, those kicks will extend the vertical distribution of high mass HMXBs, which can potentially be measured in nearby edge-on galaxies. So what are the requirements for our analysis? First of all, we need X-ray sources. So we use the list of X-ray sources provided by Binder et al. In 2015. Then we need an edge-on galaxy. We need an edge-on galaxy because in order to minimize any projection effects. Fortunately enough, the nearest to the Milky Way galaxy NGC 57 at a distance of around 2 megaparsecs, with an inclination of around 80 degrees. It's also analyzed by Binder et al. So we have a list of X-ray binaries. Then we need to produce a star-forming image in order to estimate the midplane of the galaxy and use it as a reference for measuring other distributions. Then we have to configure a model that will include the effect of the natal kicks, as well as the effect of the star formation activity. And then having estimated the vertical distribution, our final step is to estimate the travel time distribution. And from that travel time distribution, we can have an idea of the velocity that the HMX X-ray binaries are moving. Now, Binder et al. In 2015 analyzed the and classified X-ray binaries in NGC 57 as part of the Chandra Local Volume Survey, came up with 65 sources as AGN. You can see them here in red circles in the image, in the galaxy image of NGC 55. And 67 sources are classified as XRBs. Among which Binder et al. Characterized 24 as low mass X-ray binaries and 43 as high mass X-ray binaries. So our first step is to verify the catalog of Binder et al. Something is missing. Yeah, two graphs are missing. Anyway, we used a mid-infrared diagnostic. If you're familiar with what is called the Sternwedge diagnostics, which is a near infrared color diagram in which Stern et al. In 2015 placed an AGN locus. So using that mid-infrared diagnostic, we were able to reclassify five sources from high mass X-ray binary status to AGN. We also produce an HST color magnitude diagram, and we were able to verify 19 sources as high mass X-ray binaries. So our final sample for our analysis consists of 19 verified high mass X-Bs, from which we have associations with companion stars from HST fields. You can see the HST fields here as orange boxes in the figure. And we also have 35 high mass X-ray binary sources as candidate. Now, the next step is to try and identify to quantify what is the contamination with background NGN among our samples. We use three methods. The first one is the cumulative number counts of X-ray point sources provided by the CHAMP survey. The second is we use the field of view from the two Chandra observations included in the analysis. Therefore, we were able to estimate the surface density of AGN in the field of view above the D25, which is the green eclipse, above and below the D25, and apply it to the area over here, which is sort of AGN. And we also used the third method by simulating, by adding visual AGN sources within the D25 of the galaxy. And each time a new source was added, we perform a KS test to define whether the distribution of AGN within the field of view is uniform. Now, fortunately enough, all these methods came up with the same number. So approximately 40% of our 35 sources are considered as possible AGN contaminants. That translates to 15 sources among the 37 are possible AGN contaminants. The next step is to produce a star-forming image so we can identify our plane of reference. We use the IRACT 8 microns and 3.6 images, where we subtracted from the 8 micron the 3.6 image. So we were able to create a star formation image that you can see in this figure here. Using that image, we were able, first of all, to determine the midplane of the galaxy, which is the red line. Another thing, as you can clearly see from that image, is that the X-ray banners, which are depicted as X's, are clearly displaced from the star-forming region, which is this region in orange. Then we were able to measure the vertical distribution of high-mass X-ray banners from the midplane, as well as measure the SFR density. As you can see in this graph over here, the high-mass X-ray binaries are the columns in gray and yellow. The yellow ones are the verified high-mass X-ray binaries, while the gray are the candidate ones. We measured the SFR when we modeled it using an exponentially declining profile. Therefore, we are able to derive the scale height of the star formation activity, which is 0.33 kiloparsecs. And then we had to figure out a model that, as I said, had to include both the effect of the natal kick as well as the distribution of the star formation rate. We came up with a model that is actually the convolution between a Gaussian smearing function that represents a contribution of natal kicks on top of an exponentially declining star formation rate. Now, mathematically, this is the equation that represents our model. Now, in order to find the standard deviation of the Gaussian smearing function, we had to maximize the likelihood of the convolution. And we did that by performing 100,000 iterations. Now, we tried to include the AGN contamination within our iteration. That's why each iteration included actually a different set of high-mass X-ray binaries, because we randomly selected combinations of 22 out of the 35 candidate high-mass X-ray binaries. And at the end, we came up with a number that is the standard deviation or the average displacement of high-mass X-ray binaries from the star-forming region. Here you can see we have in red is the exponential star-forming region. The green is the Gaussian smearing function representing the natal kick. And the dashed black line is the convolution, that is the displacement of the high-mass X-ray binaries. Now, The problem that is that the value that we came up with is just an upper limit, because apart from other factors, include mainly the contamination from AGN, incompleteness at lower frequencies, as well as in situ formation of high mass X-binaries. And each of these factors can bias the result towards higher values. So next, we try and constrain as much as possible our result, first of all, by looking into the contamination from AGN. Now, we consider two extreme cases. We consider, first of all, the 15 possible AGN contaminants to be the HMX XBs with the largest distances from the midplane, and we come up with a scale height of 0.33 kiloparsec. Again, we make another extreme assumption that all candidate HMX XBs are AGN, so we apply our analysis on our verified sample. Again, the HMX XBs are displaced from the star forming region no less than 0.39 kiloparsecs. Then we have to take into account the incompleteness at the lower luminosities. There are three effects that contribute to the incompleteness. First is the dependence of the point response function of the off-axis angle, which is significant at regions more than 8 arc minutes from the aim point. Unfortunately, enough, we have very few sources within that region, no more than 3. So it doesn't have any significant effect on our result. Then it is the presence of diffuse emission of the galaxy. Again, Sobar et al. In 2006 investigated the diffuse emission of NGC 55 using XMM Newton data, and came out that, again, the diffuse emission is very low at around 5%. So again, it has no significant effect on our result. And then there is a high column density near the midplane, which in case of edge-on galaxies is much more prominent. Now, in order to quantify that effect, we perform another simulation by adding again virtual high-mass XBs in the region, let's say at the far side of the galaxy, considering as near side the one where we have our line of sight. And again, each time we added the source, we estimated what is the observed scale high. And the maximum deviation from our observed scale high, it is around 20% with the addition of approximately 10 to 15 sources on the far side of the galaxy. And our last issue has to do with the in situ formation of high mass X-ray binaries in extraplanar regions. That is what is the case that a high mass X-ray binary is actually formed or born in locations away from the midplane, as shown here in the figure. So we produce an H-alpha flux image, and we try to measure the fraction. We try to figure out a measurement, a way to have a measure on the flux from the extraplanar to planar region. So we use the fraction of early type stars in those regions. Again, we found that that fraction is less than 6%. So again, it has no significant effect on our results. So in the end, the displacement of high mass XBs is confined between 0.33 and 0.75 kiloparsec. With incompleteness and mainly the high column density can affect both results by as much as 20%. Now we came up with a number. The next step is to evaluate the result. By doing so, we applied our analysis in the Milky Way HMX X-ray binaries. So we first cross-correlated the HMX XB catalog of Liu et al. From 2006. With Gaia DR2, the Gaia DR2 catalog, we found 26 matches. So we performed an analysis on those 33 matches. As an SFR activity region, we chose the OB star distribution published by Kong and Zhu in 2008 that has a scale height of 103 parsecs. And our result came out with a number that indicated that the HMXBs X-ray binaries in the Milky Way are displaced by 140 parsecs, which is in agreement with previous estimates that came up from 85 parsecs from Yudovina et al. In 2003, up to 240 parsecs from Dean et al. In 2005. Now, we must know that although the vertical distribution of HMXBs X-ray binaries in NGC 55 or the displacement of HMXBs X-ray binaries in NGC 55 is greater than in the Milky Way, if you remember, we came up for NGC 65 with a number between 0.33 kiloparsecs up to 0.57, while in the Milky Way we have 0.14 kiloparsecs. We attribute this difference in the greater gravitational potential of the Milky Way. Pifl et al., for example, estimated that the local galactic escape velocity is in an order of 500 kilometers per second. And we estimated the same escape velocity using the same gravitational profiles, and we came up with a number at 100 kilometers per second, which is much less than the Milky Way. So the next step is to try and estimate the transfer velocity of HMXBs. We again configured the model by keeping in mind that the vertical distance where HMXB is located equals where the place within the star forming region that the HMX X binary is formed, plus the distance that the HMXB has traveled since the formation of the compact object. That travel distance can be found if we have travel time information. If we do have the travel time information, then we can estimate the center of mass transfer velocity. This is also multiplied by a factor sine, theta, and cos phi, which accounts for the random direction the kick will move the system, since we assume that the kick distribution is isotropic. So what we have to do is that we already have produced the distribution of the special distribution of high mass X-ray binaries, as well as the distribution of the star formation distance. We use travel time distribution from binary population synthesis codes from Andrews et al. In 2019 for two different star formation history models, an exponential and a flat one. Therefore, drawing numbers from those three distributions, that is the distribution of HMXBs X-ray binaries, the star formation distribution, and the travel time distribution, we are able to produce the center of mass transfer velocity distribution for our two star formation histories. So for an exponential star formation history, we have that the HMXBs are traveling at speed of around 22 kilometers per second. And for a flat star formation history at a speed of 48 kilometers per second. So what are the results of our analysis? First of all, we were able to identify that there is actually an extended distribution of high mass X-ray binaries compared to the star forming activity distribution. That displacement of high mass X-ray binaries from the star formation region is between 0.33 and 0.57 kiloparsec. Now, the transfer velocity of HMXBs X-ray binary strongly depends on the star formation history of the galaxy. So we found out that for a flat star formation history, HMXBs are traveling at velocity between 34 and 48 kilometers per second, which is consistent with the space velocity of Milky Way HMXBs X-ray binaries. And for an exponential star formation history model, with the starburst at 100 mega years ago, HMXBs are traveling with a velocity of 21 kilometers per second, which is consistent with the corresponding velocities in the SMC and LMC. Another thing that we also found is that formation efficiency of XRBs in NGs 55, that is the number of high-mass XBs per star formation rate, is consistent with the formation efficiency of XRBs in both SMC and LMC, but it's significantly larger than that of the Milky Way, which we attribute to the subsolar metallicity of both the Magellanic Clouds and NGs 55, which is in agreement with recent papers and theoretical population synthesis models that actually confirm that the metal poor galaxies tend to have a higher formation efficiency. So that's more or less the end of my talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the interesting talk. We may have time for a very short question if there is someone who wants to ask something. Grigoris Maravellis, but very short, please.
Okay, I had two, so I will just split it and ask for the second. Bobby, nice work. Do you plan to do something similar in other galaxies?
Maybe. Not a yes or a no, I know. Well, if I have the time, which for the time being, it doesn't seem to be the case. But yes, sometime in the future, yeah, hopefully. We already have some preliminary measurements for some other galaxies, but we are currently focused on other subjects. But yeah, in the future, yeah, we will use that analysis in other galaxies as well.
What I want to ask in more detail is, would you target also edge-on galaxies, or this work can be extended in other cases?
We haven't figured out how to, let's say, apply the same analysis in galaxies that are not edge-on, because our analysis is based on measuring the vertical distances from the midplane of the galaxy. So that requires edge-on galaxies with high inclination. We haven't figured out how to do the same analysis in, for example, face-on galaxies or in other kinds of galaxies.